Wann ist er denn?
Bald gleich.
Ewig?
Ja. Ready live?
Yeah.
Okay. So we're now live on. We're now live on three platforms. This is the TCRC Community Podcast for Wednesday, December 4th, 2019. And I would like to thank our guest for the evening, which is Derek McKnight and Robert Hayes Hart, who are the minds of men. And you guys are gonna have to share that mic, you know, so lean into it. And we would like to say that this has certainly been a momentous day. A lot of things are going on today. First of all, this was a day that Kamala Harris, who has been a presidential candidate, announced that, in fact, yesterday she announced that she was dropping out of the race, and almost immediately, today, the former Vice President Joe Biden said that he would consider Kamala Harris as a potential running mate, as his vice presidential running mate. And I've been saying this from the very beginning, that Kamala Harris and many of the other candidates, like Cory Booker, were actually running to be vice president. That Joe Biden was going to likely be the presidential candidate. The rest of the folks were in effect running for second place. Now with the addition of the billionaire in the race, it's changed a little bit, but it is significant that as soon as she dropped out of the race, Joe Biden announced that he would consider her. And when you think of a Joe Biden and Kamala Harris ticket, it has what a lot of folks would like to see, a president with experience in the White House, and a black woman in the mix. So what do y'all think about that?
Well, thank God for last night's rest, this morning's rise. Thank God for his grace and his mercy. Grace has always given me what I don't deserve, but mercy has not given me what I do deserve. And for that, I'm eternally grateful.
Introduce yourself.
My name is Derek McKnight from Minds of Men. And I want to thank you, brother Harrell, for having me and my partner Robert Hayes on your show. And it's truly an honor, and you do great work, and it's an honor to be here.
Well, it's an honor to host you. It's an honor to have you here.
Thank you, brother.
And Drew, what do you think about Kamala being considered as a vice presidential candidate? Talk to the mic, please.
I think it's a really good... Thank you. It's a very strategic move on both sides. It'll help them with funding, which there was some talk about them, her having lack of funding and finding the right marketplaces to touch on and different places that she should go and do rallies in. So I feel like both of them coming together will be a very positive thing and a really good ticket.
Okay, and we do, there's a disclaimer, this is not a political show. We don't say on the show to vote for this person, and we don't do that, you know, but we do discuss the news, and we do discuss what's going on that impacts the community. So what politicians do impacts our community, mm-hmm. And the prospect of a black woman being a heartbeat away from the presidency is something a lot of folks would like to see, mm-hmm. And by the same token, there's a lot of folks who would not want to see that. They definitely don't want to see a black woman anywhere near the White House or anywhere near having the potential to be president. So it is going to be extremely interesting. And that's not all that happened today. You know, a lot of things are happening today. And this is, you know, something that we can't avoid talking about because it's news and it impacts the community. Many folks will, first before I do anything, let me invite some more folks. What I did earlier today, you know, was I announced who was going to be on our program, and I sent out invitations so that folks would, you know, tune in. And I thank the folks who are looking to tune in at 8 o'clock on Monday and Wednesday, Friday on a regular basis. And we're definitely not trying to be on CP time. You know, this is not the Negro Network. So we're gonna try to start on time and end on time with every broadcast. But while I am also inviting people, we had the situation today where, and many folks who have been watching the podcast and they know me on a personal level and they watch my community work, know that as a individual and as a community activist, not as a TCRC, we supported the candidacy of Mobita Johnson-Harrell, who ran in the 190th district in
West Philadelphia. Are you guys related by any chance?
No, we're not related. No. We call ourselves family. We have the same last name, mm-hmm. and there's not that many Harrells, you know. Mm-hmm. So we look back in our family history, and we're not related, you know, but we feel like family. She and Yancey are long-standing friends, you know, and I love them both, and I've supported them. I supported her work at the Charles Foundation, and when she worked for the DA's office with Larry Krasner, and in her run for the state rep for the 190th district. And I did that because I respect her character, and I especially respect the work that she's done in the community. For those of you who don't know the story of Mobita Johnson-Harrell, both her father and her brother and her son, her 18-year-old son, Charles, were all victims of gun violence. Mm. And when you look at a family that is decimated by gun violence, and yet they don't throw their hands up and go hibernate somewhere, instead they work in the community and they build the Charles Foundation, and they build a body of work that has been going on for over 25 years. And that is why we support community activists turned politicians who do serious work in the community. Unfortunately, at this point in time, she is going to resign her state representative's chair and face allegations of misuse of funds, not from the Charles Foundations, but from the Motivations, Education, and Consultant Associates, MECA, which was a nonprofit that she founded. And it is alleged that she took more than $500,000 from that nonprofit. And according to Attorney General Shapiro, she's agreed to resign her seat and to plead guilty to charges that include perjury, tampering with public records, theft by unlawful taking, theft by deception, and contributions of corporations. And what she said was, "I am saddened and dismayed by the nature of the allegations brought against me. I vigorously dispute most of these allegations. I intend to accept responsibility for any wrongdoings that I've done before I took office. I have always fought for the people of West Philadelphia to the best of my ability." And I would like to say,
I have a quick question. Mm-hmm. What district exactly does she represent, or was she accountable for?
At the 190th, you know, which is one of the largest districts in the city of Philadelphia, and it's a West Philadelphia district.
What part exactly, part of the city? Is it Topside? Is it Bottomside? Is it Overbrook? Is it Drexel?
Well, what I would suggest, you know, not only for you, but for anyone who is interested in politics, there's a website called Committee of 70, and that shows all of the districts. You know, it shows all of their boundary lines. She has Gerard Avenue. She has a large chunk of West Philadelphia. You know, where the exact boundaries are, you'd have to see on the map. But trust me, it's the largest state representative district in, you know, the entire city. So, and a lot of folks have been saying a lot of outrageous things all day on Facebook. And my take on this is, no one should be judged by what they did on the worst day of their life. And as a former bank robber, I did 25 years in federal prison, and I've done a lot of things in my life, you know, that I'm not, well, that I'm not proud of. I'm not exactly ashamed of, because I like robbing banks. You know, I was young then and had a totally different mindset. And my mindset was that the government was the oppressor, and when you took money from your oppressor, you were doing the right thing. Well, that's a fallacious argument, you know, and I've since learned much better than that. But at the time that I was involved in that criminal activity, that's what I was, a criminal. But I never feel like I'm in a position to cast aspersions or cast stones on the behavior of any other human being. You know, yes, there are things that we do that we're not proud of. There are things that we do that are wrong. And while I'm not a Christian, I do love gospel music. And one of my favorite songs is "We Fall Down, But We Get Up." And I think that it's extremely important that when we make mistakes and we fall down and we transgress, mm-hmm. that we understand that what is important now is to get up, dust yourself off, and to determine what your character is. Who are you really? You know, what are you going to do from this point on? What are you going to do to atone for the things that you've done wrong in the past? And what are you going to do to move your future forward? And I think it'll be interesting to, you know, see the life path and the life journey, because I don't think that we have seen the last of Sister Mobita Johnson Harrell. And I think that she still has many more things. She's destined to do many more things in the future.
I see this. I'm from Baltimore. I'm from Baltimore City. And I've been here in Philadelphia for 19 years. And we have a mayor, she's a female, and she's under investigations also too, because she was writing books when she wasn't mayor. And now come to find out that allegations that she'd been selling books on paper, but was really keeping the money. Something went down, it's malicious, whatever, so she had to resign. So my whole point is, like, politics is a dirty game, right? Especially for us as black folks, we already behind the eight ball. So, like you say, Brother Rell, we all got passed. We all did dirt. So, even those in Harrisburg, in Washington, whatever like that, everybody did dirt, right? So, if you're a threat, if you're powerful, if you have integrity, if you can't, you won't compromise, if you're sincere, if you're for the people, if you're going to start shaking the foundation, if you're going to start rocking the boat, if you're going to start upsetting people, if you're gonna dismantle the money functions and all that madness, then you're gonna have to go. You're not gonna stay long. They're gonna find a way to get rid of you. Just like they did Bill Cosby, like they did so many other people. But they never talk about what's really going on. So we as black folks.
Bill Cosby is a whole other show.
We as black folks, we cannot play games like they play games. We gotta have integrity. We gotta be honest. We gotta be non-compromising. And we gotta stick to the script, you know, because, you know, sometimes they say power corrupts. So, you know, it's nothing new.
Power corrupts, absolutely.
Mm-hmm. Right, so it's nothing new. I mean, we've seen this season after season after season. That's one sometimes I really don't want to vote, because voting for who? And I don't know her or whatever like that, but I just wish the best for her. But I'm all for black folks, give black folks a chance. But if you got some black folks that are Oreos, they black on the outside, but they just straight up white on the inside. So they won't fight too far. They become political prophets before election, and then become political prostitutes when they get elected. That's not all, but that's just some. So I just hope the allegations on her, you know what I'm saying? It's like she don't, you know, I wish the best for her and her family and all that. My condolences to the loved ones that she's lost.
Yes.
Yes.
And she's a powerful sister, and, mm-hmm. you know, just to have gone what she... You know, what she went through, mm-hmm. and still functioning on a daily basis is incredible. You know, I try to imagine, you know, how I would think if I had lost my father and my brother, you know, and my son to gun violence. You know, mm-hmm. I mean, I tend to think I'm a strong person and I could endure it. You know, but you never know, you know, what you can endure, and you never know what in life is going to break your spirit or, you know, make you stop functioning. Mm-hmm. And I really do believe, you know, I mean, some folks look at it like it's a cliche, you know, but I really believe that we shouldn't be judged by what we do on certain days of my life. You know, I've had days of my life when I've done some straight scandalous shit, you know, and I don't want to be judged by the past that I've recovered from, and I want folks to see me for the striving that I'm trying to do. And I misstep now, and something happens that blackens my character or casts me in a bad light. You know, I don't want the work that I'm doing to be affected by that, you know. So I'm always trying to give other folks the benefit of the doubt, you know, because we are not perfect. And I mean, I want to show, be sure where I'm constantly throwing out scriptures, because I'm not a preacher, you know, but I'm reminded by what Jesus said, he who is without sin,
cast the first stone.
Cast the first stone. Mm-hmm. And that's real, you know. If you're a real person, mm-hmm. you know, and you look in the mirror, and you ask yourself, am I perfect? Are there things in my life that I would not want to see exposed? Are there things that I've done that I know is wrong, but I've gotten away with? So if that's the case, and that's the case for many of us, so how are you going to throw stones at someone else who has failed in their life work, even if it's a spectacular failure? And the reality is, the media and society, they love to drag somebody down. Mm-hmm. That's the favorite pastime of not just social media, but media in general and ordinary people. Mm-hmm. Many times, instead of people seeking to say, damn, that brother's doing a good job. You see those minds of men, brothers? You know, they're out there in the community. You know, they're dealing with young people. They're doing this, they're doing that. No, they won't do that. They'll be like, niggas think they all that. They ain't that much. You know, look at their past. Right. They used to be this, they used to be that. Mm-hmm. That's the mentality people have.
Right.
Always looking at the negative. Mm-hmm. You know, instead of looking at how folks have turned the negative into the positive and how they move forward.
Exactly.
So saying that, explain a little bit, you know, the work of Mind and Men's and, you know, what you and Brother Robert try to do.
Okay, in 2006, we had, we got started. We had 407 murders in Philadelphia, which gave birth to our organization, Minds of Men. And we said Minds of Men because everything starts with the mind. Out of the mindset of Steve Jobs came Apple Computer.
Yes.
Out of the mindset of Mark Zuckerberg came Facebook.
Okay.
Out of the mindset of Barry Gordy came Motown.
Hold on now. Barry Gordy did a whole lot of stealing, a whole lot of robbing.
But, right. Okay, but
he made some great music. He fleeced a whole lot of people.
But the mind is powerful. So how we think is how we, you know, how we operate. And so we say men, because men are supposed to be the leaders of the families, their homes, and their communities. And when men are there spiritually, mentally, economically, physically, legally, socially, we suffer, and everything connected to us as men suffer as well. That's potential, our women and our children. I met my partner, my confidant, homeboy, Brother Robbie Hayes, in the year 2009 at the Freedom Theater. Okay. We was doing a presentation. Rob came through with Little Atticus comic book, and we've been together every day since. All
right.
So every day we on the front lines.
Y'all definitely be together, because when I see one, I see the other.
We're on the front lines, and I've been clean off of drugs for 12 years.
So explain a little bit about that, you know, because folks want to know your background and you know, what brought you to the point where you said, this is enough? Because in our community, there's a whole lot of folks and there's a whole lot of listeners who have families, and they're despairing, mm-hmm. because they can't help their sons and their daughters who are strung out on drugs and just, you know, lost.
I started smoking weed like a lot of people do. And weed, you have tolerance. So one bag of weed did the job. Then I got, my tolerance went up. Then it went to two bags. And before you know it, I started experimenting. And I start putting salt on my collard greens. Anybody know what I'm talking about? That's smoking woolies, crack on weed, right? And then from there, I came to Philadelphia. I started tricking. And when I started tricking, I was starting to trick with those girls that were smoking coke. I got curious. I tried to hit the pipe. And I was a straight up crackhead for 7 years out of 20 years doing drugs. So I was in the matrix. I was in a spiritual coma. I was sick. I was crazy. I was the dead man walking for years. So it's only until I had enough pain, I was ready to what? Make a change. So I've been in eight recovery programs.
Slow down for a second right there.
Yes, sir.
You know, for a lot of the families who have sons, daughters, nieces, nephews, cousins who are caught up in that drug matrix, and they're seeking help for them, and seem like they can't find help. What you just said is extremely important. Say that again about, you know, how it had to come from internal when you wanted to change.
Right. So I had to have enough pain that I had to make a change. That what I would love to do, what I like to do, is killing me, right? The coke, for me, made me horny. It made me, I'm horny by nature, but coke made me super horny. And then right there, it was like, boom. It was hard to divorce that, right? But at the end of the day, my mother was crying. At the end of the day, I wasn't washing my ass. That's as far as the cuss I say, but anyway. I became a stranger to soap and water. I wasn't washing up. I wasn't paying rent. I was just a bum. I was a derelict, all of that. And my mother didn't give birth to no bum or no crackhead or no junkie. So I had to realize that, listen, you want to die or do you want to live? And then it was no gray areas. It was no sugarcoating. It was like, dirt, you got to change. So I went to one first rehab. I wasn't ready. Second time, I thought I was ready. Third time, I tried to get ready. Fourth time, I was talking clean and living dirty. Fifth time, I'm still faking the funk. Sixth time, I'm lying, dope fiending. Seventh time, I'm getting ready. Eighth time, I'm ready. So it took eight chances to get 12 years clean. Yeah. And everybody's journey is different. So all I say is the endorphins and serotonins are the pleasure release chemicals in the brain. And whenever, when it goes off, to protect us, also to give us pleasure. And coke always used to make my endorphins or serotonins ring, right? That's just like somebody who loved to boost with money order. It's like some people love to do home invasions or duct taping, like you say, robbing banks.
Bank robbing, listen. Bank robbing was my drug, bro.
You get a
listen. When I jumped over that counter and laid anybody down and cleaned out top bottom drawers, I was out of the door in 2 minutes.
Uh-huh.
That's a hell of a rush, man.
Exactly.
I'm telling you.
Right.
This guy here, he didn't believe I was no bank robber.
Oh, yeah?
You know, first, he's like, man, stop playing. You ain't robbing no banks. Yeah. Okay.
But
everybody who looked like a civilian ain't no civilian.
And see, my mother was my biggest enabler. Because I understand when you're talking about the mothers and the parents out there who still crying and screaming and praying for their loved ones who's still using drugs.
Yes.
So my mother would give me money so I won't break and rob house, your house, or his house, because y'all kill me.
Thinking she helping you.
Ah, exactly.
She ain't helping you.
But she was just enabling me,
she's
right?
Enabling.
So I know how it is
now.
She's
hurting you.
Huh?
She's hurting you.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Out of love, she's hurting you.
Right. And see, my mother didn't know about no program. She didn't know, because she don't do drugs. My father, he was the one that did the drugs and all of that. So, you know, the drinking and all of that. So, like I said, once I came out of the coma, and then I got my life together, then the whole thing about recovery is you got to make meetings, you got to have a sponsor, you got to do step work, and you got to consistently do it. Because if we don't do those things to help us stay clean, we start singing the relapse anthem. I stop praying. I stop believing. I stop going to meetings. I stop talking about me. I stop being in service. I stop doing things to help me stay clean. So we start singing the relapse anthem. I did that too. So until they bury me 6 feet deep, there's no vacations, no passports, no retreats from this thing called what? Recovery. And recovery is an active change of old ideas, thoughts, and behaviors. So change we must, or die we will. And it's hard to change, to be humble when somebody verbally disrespect you. It's hard to be honest when you've been a liar for years. It's hard to have self-control when you've been a whore for years. It's hard to walk down the street gunless when you always carry guns. It's hard to mind your business when you always been a busybody. So it's like
preach, brother, preach.
So it's hard. The old man must die so the new man can be resurrected and come to life. And that's the God part in me that I have to feed every day so the devil in me can die. So the people who are still out there struggling, our prayers go out to you. Stay in prayer. We would love to come to one of your facilities. We speak at over 40 facilities. We have Fairmount, Belmont, Eagleville, Interim House for Women,
Kirkbride,
Stop and Surrender, Everything Must Change, ODAT, DeMar, Ready, Willing, and Able. That's tomorrow at 6 o'clock, so I love what I do, right? But Rob always tells me about balance is very important.
Yes.
You know, balance is very
important. Better do self-care.
Better be good. Yeah. Exactly. So, you know, so you can do groups and all that, but your lights be off. You hear what I'm saying? So it's all about balance. So So, and another thing too is like I had a premonition that I was watching the Mac. And I was watching the Mac and they said they had the players ball. I said, you know what, we need a recovery ball. And our first recovery ball was in 2014 on South Street at the African American
firehouse,
right? And it was had noise ordinance down there. After 10 o'clock, you can't pass gas down there. It was real serious. But anyway, we had a great time. We had the ceremony upstairs. We had to bring the tables and chairs downstairs. We ate and we danced the night away, right? And we coming up on our 6th annual recovery ball that's coming in January the 4th at the Ethical Society.
Oh, yeah, that's right downtown in Rittenhouse Square.
Yes, sir, 1908.
Hugh Morales hooked it up for you?
Huh?
Hugh Morales? Hugh Taft Morales. He runs Ethical Society.
We got a friend, Cigar Williams.
Okay.
Yeah, so we're going to be down there in January, so we definitely love people.
What's the date?
Coming up, January the 4th.
And
from 6 to 11.
How much are the tickets?
$20.
All right, so we'd like to encourage anybody who's in recovery.
Can
who
I
wants
it,
to, yeah.
Show that up?
Mm-hmm. So it's probably hard to see, you know, yeah. But what yeah, I'm going to do is right. I'm going to post this uh-huh. on my Facebook pages,
uh-huh.
on the TCRC Philly page, and on this personal page, and on our YouTube channel, you know, so that you can see it. And for those who are in recovery and want to celebrate their recovery, definitely we invite you to come out. We'd also like to invite folks who are not in recovery,
mm-hmm.
but who would like to support this effort,
mm-hmm.
to donate so that those who are in recovery who can't afford to come are able to come.
Yes.
And also, if you're a female and you got a prom dress or you got a dress that's in the closet and you ain't worn it in a long time and...
Donations.
Here's
yes,
the reality.
We need those.
You ain't never going to wear it no more. You know?
Right.
Because you done gained some weight. And you can't get in that joint.
Yeah.
Let's be real.
Yeah.
You're never going to get that dress again. Or you ain't got no man, and he ain't taking you when you wear a dress like that. Or you do got a man, and he still ain't taking you. Call these brothers up.
We'll come pick it up. Or we'll meet
take
somebody.
That dress out the closet.
Yeah.
Dust that joint off, and give it to a sister in recovery who's going to be Cinderella for a night. Who's going to look amazing in that dress. And
men for suits.
What's your brother's work?
And guys who got suits out there. Hats,
and listen.
Right. Shoes.
If you used to be a ties. Church guy and mm-hmm. you got a rack of suits in your closet and you don't go to church no more, stop thinking. Get one or two of them suits and uh-huh. donate them to the brothers.
Exactly.
Well, if you got so many suits you can't even hardly get them in your closet, take three or four of them joints out, donate them to Minds of Men. Suits, shirts, uh-huh. bow ties.
Yes, sir.
Cufflinks,
mm-hmm.
dress shoes.
Mm-hmm.
Whatever a brother can wear to make his night real. Mm-hmm. And where can they get information where they can
my
contact?
Phone, yeah, it's on the flyer, but you know, he was, you know, put it on.
I will, but go ahead and say
okay, 267-815-0230. That's Derek McKnight. Robert Hayes, 215-776.
I'm going to type it right on the screen so they can see it.
Okay. Robert Hayes, 215.
Y'all ain't shame. They call you any time of night. Come get that joint, right?
776-8642. Also, the ex-offenders. Let me say something to the ex-offenders. Anybody out there who got a record, we have job information for you. All right? Jobs. We don't make no excuses saying that nobody will hire you. That's a lie. All right?
But
we have a lot of job information for ex-offenders. All right? It might not be the job you want, but you're working. And for people who've been locked up and made 19 cents an hour, 20 cents an hour, and come home and refuse to get a job for $7 and some change, something is totally wrong. And especially when you got kids to feed, and Pico need the money, the landlord need the money, et cetera, et cetera. So any ex-offenders with any type of records on your jacket, give us a call. You don't have to wait or come to the ball. We can do you a favor and start helping you, give you some resources right now to make things a lot better for your living for your living experience. Also for housing, if we got housing
hopefully,
also.
Some of the jobs are higher than $7 an hour, aren't they?
Or more than that, yeah. I'm just making an example.
Yeah.
Just making
an don't make that example. Don't be scaring folks off. You know,
there's a lot of jobs out here.
We hope folks find jobs here,
right.
You know, but basically we only hardly look at jobs that are under $10 an hour because what that does is, here's the reality. A $10 an hour job, we'll put some money in your pocket, but not enough money. And what it'll do, it'll frustrate you, because every 2 weeks, you're getting a check that barely enables you to keep your cell phone on, pay rent, and buy food, and the rest of the time you're stuck. Mm-hmm. And when you're working hard, and you're trying to move forward, and you're stuck, sometimes that leads to your relapsing mentally. Mm-hmm. In the same way y'all talk about drug relapse, mm-hmm. at TCRC we talk about criminal relapse. Mm-hmm. Because you don't just, you know, one day decide to start selling drugs again, or robbing banks, or doing a hustle, or doing whatever. That's a gradual process where you become frustrated with the pace of your recovery and your transition, mm-hmm. and you say finally, F that, I know how to make some money. Mm-hmm. And you have relapsed in your mind first, and then you relapse
in the physical,
your real life.
And go back to the dark side. Here's some spiritual principles. This is the like medication that we give out at our recovery balls. I mean, I'm sorry, at our recovery workshops that we do. Spiritual principles. That's the antidote for me to keep me jail-free and drug-free. Yes. This is the prayer. That's foundation for me, right? To hold on, all right? To have some type of high power, to believe in it. Number two, patience. Like you say, it's not going to come when I want it to come, but it's going to come. I just got to hold on. And with the patience is the perseverance. That means come hell or high water, I got to stay righteous. I got to stay legal. I got to hold on. I got to persevere through all storms, health storms, money storms, death storms, kid storms, woman storms. Any storms come, I must stay focused and stay disciplined and stay obedient. Humility is very important. A lot of people will try to pull you off your square, right? So it's got to be humble. If they don't touch you, I have to be bigger than words. So, and got to be humble and ask for help, right? Honesty, how do I really feel today? Do I feel like doing the bad, or do I feel like just maintaining and do the right thing? Gotta be honest. I feel like selling drugs? Nope. I feel like what? Getting a job. Gotta be honest on how I feel. Understanding. I gotta understand that I have issues, right? That only that my high power can help me get through. And God works through people. So I can't be close-minded or standoffish or judgmental, because the person you might disrespect might be your angel. So open-minded is very important, right? So it's a lot of spiritual principles that must be practiced every day, right? It's like purpose. A lot of men go back to jail or get high or lose their mind or run for cover because they feel like they don't have no purpose. I didn't know what I wanted to do, so I was lost, right? And when I thought I was funny, I was telling jokes, but I wasn't really funny. I would hang mm-hmm. with this person, to hang with that person, but that didn't work out. But what we do is my purpose. When you find your purpose, you find your passion and love. I love God. I love me. I love people. And the biggest test is to love the person who don't like you.
Yes.
That's the biggest test right there, right? So it's like spiritual principles. Must practice that, eat that, and live on that every day, right? Without the medication. So some people need meds, but they try to, I'm hyped by nature. They try to put me on Ritalin. My mama said, nope, my son is not getting on Ritalin. Teach him, because that is your job. And that's what the city, our tax dollars pay you for. So,
what do you think about what the brother's saying, Drew? Talking to Mike. Please talk to Mike, because your voice is low.
Yeah, I think everything he's saying is amazing and can be applied to a specific group of people who need a little bit more attention than the rest of the regular society, mm-hmm. who need a little bit more guidance and more wisdom being given to them without a price being attached to it. Mm-hmm. I feel as though everything he's saying is positive and should be taken in and given and also shared to the rest of the others who get a chance to hear this man's amazing words.
Well, I've known the brothers for years. Brother. And are y'all still down around the corner on Butler Street?
No, we used to. We moved. Yeah, I'm in West Philly now.
Okay.
Big up to West Philly.
West Side?
Yeah, I'm in West Philly now. And
I'm in Southwest myself. I'm going to move. I'm going to move back north, man.
That's Wild Wild West.
Well, actually, you know, I live on a little quiet street. You know, the worst thing happened on my street was about a year and a half ago, this girl was getting married. And her boyfriend's ex ran down on her on their wedding day, you know, and they got into it, but she wasn't trying to fight on her wedding day. And she went off and she got some dudes and they came back and the father came out to, you know, try to moderate it, and they shot him 10 times and they shot her while she was pregnant. She lost the babies, but the father didn't die. You know, I mean, he lived, you know, and he still lived down the street. You know, so that was kind of, that was tragic. That's been like the only incident that on my block. I mean, there's some things happened around us, you know, but it's the Wild Wild West, but it hasn't, I'm in the Southwest, you know, and I'm in like a little, you know, side street off the cut, right off of Cops Creek, you know, so parks right across the street. It's a nice little spot, you know, but I'm just tired. I need to, to me, I say, move back into the city. Southwest is like on the outskirts, man. It's, you know, in the morning I got to get up, man, and get my car and drive all the way to Jersey to work. It's too much, man. I'm trying to move.
You know what?
I can jump on the boulevard and go right up.
I'm 48 years old, and I'm just still learning, right, that we don't control a woman, right? And whenever you put a woman before your high power, that's called idolatry. And women have the right to change their mind. And I'm a type of brother, I'm Aquarius, February the 5th, same day Bobby Brown's birthday, different years, but anyway. But I invest.
I
that's why I said
that. That much in common.
Because I love art, right?
My brother Wilder's a Taliban.
Because I give all, right? I give all. And come to find out, she changed her mind, right? And this really happened to me. And it took me 8 months to get this one woman out of my whole system.
Why,
you wouldn't even wash up.
Listen, I've never understood that. You know? I mean... What is it about a woman that, one, you know, makes a brother want to hold on when she's done?
Uh-huh.
If a woman tells me she's done, she got to say that once.
Uh-huh.
Excuse me, what'd you say? You done?
But it took, so like you said, done. But it took me a while
and
to get
so
there.
There's so many other beautiful, passionate,
right,
intelligent women who are looking for good men.
Mm-hmm. But when you're locked, well, for me, when I was locked in on just that right there, I worship her. I didn't say it, but
really?
That's how it was.
I thought you supposed to worship the Creator.
That's right. But see, it took that.
But no one else before him.
There you go. But it took that hurt experience for me to worship God, period. That's it. That's all. Now, I'm in a relationship right now. And if she decides to change her mind, I'll be hurt a little bit, but it won't be like it before.
Yeah.
You feel what I'm saying?
You learn from that?
There you, without a doubt.
Thank Jesus.
Without a doubt. And that's real. Right. And you got some brothers today out here, it's just straight up, that's mine. No, it's not.
Yeah.
No,
listen,
it's not.
You got some brothers who will kill.
Yes.
You know, kill the woman, kill the kids.
Yes.
You know, and then kill themselves.
That's crazy.
How can you kill yourself?
That's crazy. Look at the Chris Benoit, the wrestler, killed his whole family, then he killed himself.
Yeah.
Well, yo, murder, that's suicide. Bad. That's crazy.
I understand that.
Like I just said,
mental health is mental health.
Yeah.
So let me also say this. So, Minds of Men is a two-piece. This is Brother Derek McKnight, and now we'd also like to bring to the screen Brother Robert Hayes Hart. Thank you, Brother Derek. You know,
all
you've
right,
been very articulate. You know, very funny and very real. You know, my mind is still trying to absorb that worship thing, but I'm clicking on it.
All right.
Come on, Brother Robert. And as I like to say, you know, when I first met these brothers, I met one, and I used to live and work right down the street. And when I saw one, I knew the other one was going to be coming up the block in a minute or so, you know, because I've never seen them apart, which is a good thing. They do very, very good work. And so introduce yourself again, and talk a little bit about, you know, your recovery.
Mm-hmm.
You know, at what point did you, come to the realization you need to do something different and move in that direction?
Okay, like he was talking about earlier. Well, once again, my name is Robert Hayes, but my family's Hart. So, like on Facebook, they call me Robert Hart and all that kind of stuff. That's my family name. And you know, recovery component is so important for us because you know, at one time I had 12 years clean, and like McKnight said, we're just talking about how we can digress back into our old behavior without constant work and observation, because recovery is about self-observation. So usually society teach you to look out as opposed to looking in.
Yes.
So, you know, that's how I can relate also to being, you know, incarcerated. I was incarcerated in the military. And I was very...
What was that experience like? Because a lot of folks don't realize that the armed services has an extensive prison system. You know, so what was that like?
Well, what happened was I experienced...
First, what branch was
it? It was the Army.
Army, okay.
And I experienced... I didn't know it was racism when I was going through it. You know what I mean? You know, racism has a way of hiding itself. Through disciplinary write-ups, Article 15s and all that stuff through behaviors. So the reason why I mention is because...
What's Article 15?
Article 15 is like a charge. Okay. Like a charge so they could throw you in prison. So I was in Korea, matter of fact, and I learned a few Korean words and all that kind of
North
stuff.
North or South? Had to be South.
Well, you can say South. DMZ, matter of fact, right in the middle. And
he's in North. I'm scared of him.
Yeah. But you know what? I would tell you this. I was a rebellious young man. Because how old are you?
I'm 23. But what was the facility, the building like? How did he treat you as a person? Were you fed properly? Do you have lights? Do you have water? Do you have shelter?
You know why I was in jail?
Yeah, your mental health.
Oh, it was nice. It was ice cream up in that joint. But the thing about it was my mindset before I went there. I thought like, oh my God, because I was in jail with somebody that got drunk and sliced a cab driver's throat. They was having riots and all that. So I'm thinking I'm going to be in a cell with Hannibal Lecter. So inside my mind, I'm like, oh my God, I don't really know. You know, I didn't know I was facing systematic racism. So, you know, once I did get out, you know. I was only in jail for like 18 months. Military prison for 18 months.
And did you get dishonorable discharge or went back and up?
I got an other than honorable. Okay. Other than honorable. I could still get that stuff fixed, you know. Because actually, that's what recovery is about, getting all aspects of your life together. Yes. So when you integrate back into society, you got a fighting chance. And I really didn't know that, so as I got out at the time where the JBM was doing stuff in the street and all that, and I was doing sending me letters in jail, talking about when the drugs hit this. I said, man, I got to get out of here. Everybody making money. You know what I mean? So I signed what I had to sign to get out, and you know, that was the mindset. I was a very problematic young man.
What did you have to sign, if you don't mind me asking?
Saying I want to get out of service. You know what I mean? Signing away your rights. Yeah,
military prison. Military prison. You know, but as long as you're in the military, you'll be in that prison.
Yeah, that's right.
Once you sign and say, you know, you accept that, other than honorable discharge, you're also for release.
And so, let you go.
The military prison, it's a way to punish people in the military when they transgress.
Yeah. Yes.
And it's an incentive to make you leave the military. Testing your mind, your body, and your passion. Is that what military prison is?
Well, actually, if you do a crime, you know, you're going to have to face the consequences, right? So, as you get in there, but they do, I would tell you like this, with the systematic racism I'm talking about, you might have a traffic violation. The guy might let the person go, oh, go ahead, it's just all right, you were just having a good time. But if you get caught, you know what I mean, you got to face the full extent of the law. See, that's with their discretion, and you can't really fight that unless you could prove somebody was racially trying to, you know, target you. You know, ain't a lot of time, you, like I was his age, like 22, 23, I wasn't as conscious, you understand what I'm saying? So I just wanted to get out of the service, start a life of crime. You know what I mean? Because I thought that's what it was, because so I had a TV mind.
Intent on doing crime.
Intent. That's what I was going to do down with. I said,
that was your mindset.
Everybody getting down, everybody getting that money, I want to get some money too. You know? So that was a sickness early sickness. I wasn't that far from robbing banks either, you know, because I had some friends, they was talking about doing a lot of things, you know. And I would tell you this, when you get that type of mindset, a lot of times we don't have mentorship. You might have grew up in church.
Well, the mentorship you have is negative.
The negative mentorship.
Yes.
Yeah, because you won't have mentorship either way. You know, especially with relationships. A friend of mine said, I understand now, that as a population, we kind of dropped the ball teaching the young people about love. We not just teach them love, but we should have taught them about commitment.
Yes.
You know, because we plenty of lovers. You know what I mean? But nobody want to commit to the kids. And if you don't commit to the kids, look at this next generation. You understand what I'm saying? So it's like we've grown Frankensteins because they don't have those spiritual principles McKnight was just talking about. Mm-hmm. Integrity, perseverance. Mm-hmm. I ain't heard none of that. I, you know, somebody told me, say, yo, brother, you could be a mechanic. You know what I told him? I don't want to get my fingernails dirty.
Damn.
So,
really?
I had a whole type of mindset. I don't want to get my hands dirty.
You can scrub them joints before you count the money.
I'm just telling you. That's how I was. I was a sick puppy. So,
yeah,
what happened was, really, addiction really helped me out a lot. You know why? Because it broke that
addiction
mindset.
Broke you up?
Yeah, it breaks a mindset.
How long was your addiction?
I would say about a good 10, 12 years. And I really learned to use drugs in the service.
And when you say addiction, you mean drugs while you were in the service?
Well, I would tell you this. A lot of times people just think addiction is drugs.
It can
really
be anything.
It's a mindset.
It could be women.
It's a mindset.
It could be money.
Well, the brother said it was women.
Yeah. Well, that's how it manifested in his life, per se. And it can manifest in other people's lives, like bank robbery, domestic violence, a lot of stuff like that. But the core issue is your relationship with the universe. So you got to have a better relationship with the universe. Because my friend told me the other day, we as a people, we are digressing. We used to be more humane. Now we're almost animalistic level, shooting kids in the street, shooting pregnant women and all that. You know, back in the day, we used to drink 40s on the corner wishing somebody would do something crazy. And it would be street justice. You understand? But now, they'll sit there and let a woman get stomped in the street, shoot a baby, and everything is cool. You know what would have happened to somebody if they went to jail and they talking about they shot a baby?
Can I ask you a question? Do you regret living up in the, growing up? No, I have two questions. Mm-hmm. One, where did you grow up?
Happy Hollow. Yeah, Wayne Avenue.
Okay, so do you regret growing up in a low-income community? Do you wish you grew up in another location that was more safe and had less negative influences, or do you not wish for your life to have been anything different? And if so, mm-hmm. with any children do you have, would you take them back to Wayne Avenue?
Well, first of all, there's no happy land.
Mm-hmm.
You understand what I'm saying? So anywhere you go, you can run into negative influence, especially if you have low self-esteem.
Mm-hmm.
So you can have mom, dad, two houses in a car, 2.5 puppies, and if you got low self-esteem, you're going to go on the street and look for people to accept you. And that is really what leads you to a path of destruction, you know. So, and as for my children, you know, it's real important to play an active role in their lives, in all children. We have to play. A friend of mine told me, children are 10% of the population, but 100% of the future. So the seeds that we plant, the seeds that we grow, and we try to nurture, is going to be the harvest for tomorrow. So if we don't invest in them, like Malcolm X said, chickens come home to roost. And my thing though is on a whole note is we always talk about the butterfly, Brother Harrell. And you know the butterfly is the what? The symbol of psychology, the representation of psychology. And it starts as a caterpillar.
Symbol of change.
Yeah, symbol of change. So it starts as a caterpillar rolling in the dirt, the muck and the mire, and it winds up getting onto a tree, which turns into a what? A cocoon. And inside the cocoon is where the change process happens.
Transformation.
And beautiful thing about this is, as the butterfly start breaking through the cocoon, the blood goes through to the veins of the butterfly, and it makes it a very beautiful sight when you see the butterfly. So the moral of the story is, the harder the struggle, the more beautiful you become as a person.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what I will not throw away, my trials and tribulations, because that made me who the person I am today. And I love to help other people because, as McKnight said, we go to 40 different facilities, jails, and all that kind of stuff. And we see people on the street. They always ask us, man, we held on to that information you gave us, da-da-da-da-da-da. And we don't just give people job information for small. We try to give them a roadmap to integrate back into society.
Using your own life as
an
example.
Using our life as an example and the connection and resources that we connect with people. Because I tell you, we don't have no degrees. I try to tell McKnight all the time, we have to foster our relationships with people, because right now, you know, when you're in the spotlight, this guy used to smoke crack. This guy used to smoke joint. He used to do that. This look for him. He gonna fall down any minute.
What was your drug of choice?
Crack. Okay. I went straight to the crack.
you bypassed the herb and pill.
All that.
Straight to crack?
Yeah, 211. Well, it was 211.
How the hell
crack.
Does that happen?
I was a good study.
Just woke up in the morning and said, let me try some crack.
I was like, where's the crack? You know, God, but damn.
May I ask you a question?
That's the first time I ever heard of that joint. I'm usually like my brother, you know.
He eased said, into it.
It's a progression where you try different things. And
well, I would tell you the truth. The real story is it was a girl on Wayne Avenue. And she was bad, right?
Girl
was
involved in a whole lot of bad.
I used to hustle pool. I had some money. I tried to get with her.
You be a pool player?
Yeah, still am. Okay. All right. So I almost got with her, and this dude came along with some drugs. And he snatched away. I said, I had money, all this and that. So the next time, I said, I found out what she liked. So I got the stuff. And that thing she took, and she hit some flim-flam move on me. And then, you know what, then? I had the stuff again. I said, bunk her. I'm going to use it myself. So The fisherman got hooked on the fish. You understand what I'm saying?
That's a hell of a story there.
Yes, sir. That's what happens.
Can I ask you a question?
Yeah. You're
talking to Mike, bro. Folks can't hear you.
I feel as though people in low income situation, the neighborhoods that are highly populated with, I want to say, what could be historically said, the building blocks of a country, which is the hardworking people of African descent. And these people have been placed with not only myself, with not only John Dye, with you people from Minds of Men, have seen things that are traumatic and could be classified as almost war-like instances of violence that can affect you mentally growing up, always hearing gunshots or different type of violent activities, stabbings, high quantities of narcotics, these type of things to a developing mind, because the mind doesn't develop until after 21. So, would you say that you yourself are a person who has seen PTSD? And if so, do you look at the things that you experienced while in the Army, the extreme
output,
and after the Army, the extreme outputs of violence as playing a part in a lack of regard for your mental well-being? And how do these things end?
That was a long-ass question, boy.
Yeah, that's a good question. But actually, as we look at it, right, the African-American community has suffered like 400 years of consistent trauma. Okay. So we also know that the first mental diagnosis was called drapetomania, which means if you was a slave and you tried to run away from the plantation, they said you was crazy. So we as a community, we suffer through trauma through, I would say, centuries. You understand what I'm saying?
And systematic trauma.
Systematic, John. You know, and we also the only people who they make laws to make sure that we are in a certain type of socioeconomic condition, which is easy to take advantage of us. So when you ask that type of question, that says, like, only if you're in the hood are you going to suffer from some type of addiction or depression. So y'all always got to look at the rich people. Let's look at the rich people, too. You know, rich people get on drugs, too.
Ain't no question.
They got Maseratis. They got cars. You got Whitney Houston, $100 million contracts, and they still use drugs. So what is the common denominator? The common denominator is self-esteem. See, self-esteem is not what you think about yourself. It's how you treat yourself. So what's the difference between somebody with the, like Ted Turner? If you ever heard of Ted Turner, he walked into the bathroom. His father blew his brains out. He had brains on his shoulder. Saying he could have went on drugs. He could have just went in the corner and so forth like that. But he didn't. He took that dramatic situation, became a multi-million dollar cable giant and so forth. So it's what you do with the trauma. It's what you do with the tragedy. You understand what I'm saying? We can't let, because certain things happen in our community, use that as an opportunity or excuse to crawl under the rock. Because too many people are counting on us. So sometimes you got to shake some things off, get that therapy, start treating people the way you want to be treated, do self-care. You know, as me, myself, there's a lot of nonprofit organizations. I've decided to lend my support. You know what I'm saying? Help them with some resources. Help them look for grant money. All that kind of stuff. Because I know as an individual, I probably could have just went somewhere, got into society, made some money, and moved to Delaware. I could have did that. But I realized that until we're all home, nobody's home. So we got to use a teamwork thing, and I like those principles in Kwanzaa, because Kwanzaa is very important. And those are our spiritual principles that we really need to focus on. Because if you start dealing with the unity, economics, and one of the biggest reasons why we in such a dismay is because we don't have black businesses in our community.
Yes.
You don't have...
I've been saying that forever.
You should be
economics
like
economics is the key to rebuilding our community.
You should be...
You ain't talking about money, you know, it just don't make sense.
If it ain't don't make dollars, it don't make sense.
So can I ask another question?
Mm-hmm.
We got 6 minutes left, so don't make your question 5 minutes. Bro.
Okay, so you said that if it doesn't make dollars, it does not make sense. And you saying that we need some type of economic engine to run what is the black community, and in turn, all communities, right?
Let me give you an example. If you walk around this corner, mm-hmm. right? You have a commercial quarter running down Germantown Avenue.
That's right.
You at least got 100 businesses.
Easy.
I would say there's only about 5 or 6 black-owned businesses on that whole quarter.
If that.
If that. All
right. You know the danger
so
in that?
So the reality is, kids come home from school, kids coming from Simon Gratz, walking down to the somewhere, getting on the bus,
mm-hmm.
should be going to these stores and putting a backpack behind the counter and have an after-school job. But they can't do that because these businesses are owned by white and Hispanic and Asian merchants
mm-hmm.
who hire their own families, hire their own people. So when we say unless we control the economics, we're talking about the dollar circulating in the hood many, many times.
So
it don't do that.
The question:
our dollars goes right into the pockets of folks who don't look like us. So as long as we don't control our economics,
we're at their mercy.
Any questions we ask
mm-hmm.
aren't going to have an answer.
So, what do you think has to be done to change these things in a way that will completely eradicate the poverty that has stricken our communities?
Mm-hmm. Well, I will say this. My father just passed away November the 9th, right? And he passed away. He didn't have an insurance policy. So I'm sitting there like, man, I did just have a couple dollars, but I just spent it because we was, you know, doing the recovery bond, a few other things. I was like, oh man, because that always happens when you don't expect it.
Yes.
So my
death
sister
is not on the schedule.
That's right. Come when it want him. So my sister came out and she bust out like $8,000. Like it was, you know what I mean? I was like, oh man. So I had to realize that finances is a very important part of society, and we don't have these conversations enough.
Yes.
So some members of my family owns a bakery in Southwest. We're gonna open it back up. We're gonna create a family business. You know, the culture, business should be a culture inside your family.
Yes.
You should have these conversations. You should talk to a young man. I should have a business, and if you got a nephew that need a job, you should be able to ask me, I can give him a job. Yes. That's how
instead
they can
of
look up to each other.
Instead of going downtown to a agency and getting sent over to Jersey to work in a factory for
$11,000. Another form of slavery.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Another form of slavery.
Yes.
So ain't nothing like working for yourself. And that's something that we don't appreciate. And that's one of the reasons why some of the young men don't respect the older men in our community, because we can't do certain things for them. So when I say it don't
have to
make dollars, we have to provide for them. So when I say if it doesn't make dollars, it doesn't make sense. I'm not talking in a physical sense. I'm talking in a spiritual sense. We have to be able to provide for our wives. We have to be able to provide for our kids. Every time our kids go to college, oh, we're going to get a grant from the which one? That's putting them in poverty. It's putting them in debt. Yes. I didn't even think about
it. I got student loans right now. That's crazy.
You understand? I didn't even think about maybe I could pay for my own child's college. Mm-hmm. See, we don't have those conversations.
But see, a lot of white folks, they start saving for their kids a college education
before
they're
born.
When they're in kindergarten.
Even before they're born. They
yes.
got trust funds.
Yes.
We don't know nothing about those. We don't know financial education.
A lot of wealthier folks have trust funds.
Mm-hmm.
Ordinary people start saving money when their kids are in kindergarten, grade school, through middle school. By the time they finish high school, most of their college is funded. But I hate to say it, a lot of black people don't have long-range vision. And that's something that we really need to work on as individuals, as families, as a community, and as a race of people.
And you know why that comes from? If you ever get a chance to, young man, what's your name again?
My name's Andrew.
Brother Andrew.
Call me Drew.
Brother Drew. If you get the chance, read a book called The New Jim Crow. You ever heard that before?
Yes, I have.
Michelle Alexander.
Very, very good. And it talks about like how...
I think I might be on the shelf.
How
we got a serious library here.
I've seen that, John. History of Africa. But, you know, what that showed was how racism is a game that is played on people. It also showed how it creates a mindset that we're not going to live long. So that's how you living in a project and you got a Benz. You understand what I'm saying? You know, a lot of people I heard, they say they're about to die or something like that, and they ain't got no insurance. Well, I ain't going to be here. I ain't got to worry about it. So no, we don't have legacy.
You should be leaving something for your kids.
We don't have legacy mindset. Uh-huh. And that's what Minds of Men is about. Minds of Men is about putting men in a position where we can be men again, that women can look up to us, our children can look up to us. At the Recovery Ball, we'll say this real quick before we out of here. We're doing the first ever recovery lottery we're going to pay the security. We're going to pay the security and a down payment to move somebody into their own apartment.
That's big.
And it's going to be like a lottery. We're going to pay the security and down payment so they can move into an apartment. We want them to pay
the
money.
So you buy a ticket for this when you come to the Recovery Ball?
What's happening is
the lottery work.
Is for the lottery works like people in recovery programs in the transitional phase.
Okay.
We want to make sure that they got a job, they got some clean time together,
okay,
and they're referred by
so
their
some, okay, yes.
Like
yes.
In other words, if you had somebody in your program,
so you get a pool of those people,
a refer
and
from
then
you
at the Recovery Ball, you know, all those folks, you have a drawing and
exactly
one person will win.
Because we want responsible
that's
people.
Big.
We don't want to just get somebody in no apartment and it's the
and they bullshit.
Taj Mahal.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So we need people, program directors, to start giving. And we can pick some people and help them. And look, we want them to pay their 1 month rent. You know why? Because we want to show them responsibility.
Yes.
We don't want to give them no easy ride. You know how it is when people get that easy ride, they don't respect.
Listen, so many folks come out of jail
mm-hmm.
and they get that 6 months
free housing. BCC.
And
BBC.
After 6 months, they ain't saved no money, have no idea how to pay rent.
No vision.
And they're worse off than when they first came out of jail.
Ain't that a trip?
We really got to do for self. You know, there's a brother down in South Philly. I've got this organization called Do For Self. You know, and I like that term. I like that idea.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we have to do for ourselves. You know, we have to look at how can we structure our lives so that at some point we can become self-sufficient, and that's extremely, extremely important. I'd like to thank my brother Robert Hayes Hart and
yeah, right.
brother Derek McKnight, you know, Minds of Men, you know, for coming to the podcast, not only telling a story, but being real. I mean, it takes heart and fortitude and realness to say, I used to smoke crack, you know, I used to be a sex addict, you know, I used to do this.
The real crack.
Yes. Damn, bro. That was my addiction. That's who I was, you know. But now, this is who I am now. And this is the process that helped me change.
Mm-hmm.
And if you know somebody, if you love somebody, you know, if you have somebody in your family who is going through that,
mm-hmm.
you know, maybe at some point in time.
People in the street.
Did you apply for the new one?
I got to put another one. I think I did. I'm going to
talk
to them.
They just had one like last month.
Okay. I ain't heard back from them, but they need to get with people in the street.
Yeah. Well, a lot of brothers been saying that. I mean, like, y'all was listening when Third Eye was grinding folks up. And let me say this, all right? There are times when on the podcast,
mm-hmm.
you know, I will call out, you know, certain things that are wrong with the city or are wrong with the structure. You know, but I would like to just call out folks, you know, for the sake of sensationalism,
mm-hmm.
you know, say some real shit. You know, don't just be about causing a social media stir, you know, and getting more likes. That's
mm-hmm.
bullshit.
Mm-hmm.
If you got something real to say, and if you got a solution,
uh-huh.
you know, don't just be dogging people. And in your own personal life, you ain't doing shit to make the world better.
Mm.
You just talking. And a whole lot of folks do that.
Mm-hmm.
They just be rapping.
Mm-hmm.
you know. But in their personal life, they ain't doing a damn thing to move folks into a better situation. They're outside of a little personal series.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'm not talking about, you know, those in your circle, like your wife or your, you know, your family.
Mm-hmm.
You're supposed to be taking care of them. That's your responsibility. What are you doing to impact the community on a larger level? Mm-hmm. If you ain't doing nothing, stop throwing bricks at folks who are trying to do something, you know, whether they do it well or whether they fail.
Mm-hmm.
At least they're trying to do something.
Mm-hmm.
Go sit down some damn way. That's what I be saying. So we're now 5 minutes over time, but it was a good 5 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
And I do thank you, brothers, for coming on. And
thanks for having us, brother.
I would also like to say, as TCRC's contribution to Mind to Men's and to your work, what I can do is I'm going to show y'all when we get done our activity room.
Okay.
And if y'all want to have an evening, you know, we use the activity room where you bring brothers in, you know, let's sit down and discuss how the TCRC Community Healing Center can support the work you're doing and how you can interact with us to help folks right here in the community, you know, that we both love and care for.
Say no more.
Mm-hmm.
All right. So as always, in the closing we say, peace, power, and respect. Take care of your family and all those who you love. Peace.
Again, peace, power, respect, love, blessings. Yeah, of course, of course, of course.
I got this
one. Mr. Harrell, we're going to get a picture with you, Mr. Harrell.
We'll definitely do that.
Yes, sir, yes, sir, yes, sir.
Not only can we get a picture, we can use a tripod and do a time registry.
What's that?